Herzlich willkommen zurück. Ich freue mich jetzt sehr auf das nächste Gespräch. Wir haben
Right, we are looking forward to this next discussion, as Tobi Müller has already mentioned. There's kind of a red thread going through the events this evening. Now we are going to continue to talk about the corona crisis, which has magnified the weaknesses and strength of the digital society and economy. Now we would like to know what are the lessons learned from the crisis in the Social Democratic Party after the experience gained in recent months, and what can we do in order to ensure that we're not going to go back to business as usual, but how can we set the tracks for a better digital future? This is what I would like to discuss with Saskia Esken. She's a member of the German Parliament and the co-chairman of the SPD. Saskia, we're happy to have you here tonight. Hello. Let's start off on a personal note. What was the most important transformation for you in recent months? Well, everything that we did in the past and luckily whenever we met, on a personal note, but now we have to do it in a digital fashion. But, you know, with the county presidents of the party, we met once a year in the past, but now we wanted to have a meeting every 6 weeks. So for that purpose, we organized telcos. And now Corona sort of amplified these developments. We want to communicate as much as possible, and we want to communicate often, and we have to use digital media for that purpose right now. Now, I was always wondering, several fine. You've been interested in digital topics for quite some time, and you also want to give shape to this process of digital transformation in our country, but that doesn't hold true for all of your party members, and maybe not all of your party members are aware of that. Is it right to speculate that now that everybody is forced to use digital tools and platforms and use digital devices in their daily basis, that this will lead to a fundamental transformation? Yes, this really gives a boost to digital platforms. But I would like to say the following. For me personally, a lot of things have changed because we have a digital committee in the Bundestag, because many of our colleagues who cooperate with us from all the different political parties were also in different committees. I was also a member of a committee on education during the first term of office. And here I try to promote digital issues as well, and I try to do a lot of convincing, successfully so, because others managed to do that in other committees, the Committee on Legal Affairs or Economics as well. And I think this is how we managed to bring about a lot of transformation, at least in the mindsets of the people. Policymakers, digital policies, being digital, becoming digital, organizing digital conferences, this is what a lot still remains to be done. And I do that as a volunteer, but also with amongst my colleagues, because they think that, well, sooner or later, Corona will be over, and then we can get back to business as usual and hold ordinary, regular conference. I think the hybrid conferences provide us with so much more potential because many more people can participate who would otherwise not join us because it's too far away or whatever. So we should continue to stick to that particular format. Yes, absolutely so. I always see that when I participate in hybrid events or digital events, be it people with physical disabilities. So yesterday I gave a talk when somebody was there from South Africa without any CO2 emissions at all. So I think we should stick to these formats in the future in one way or another. And it's really good to hear how the digital mainstreaming can be promoted in the Parliament's committee. I think you probably did not deal with digital politics that much in recent years, but in recent days, but rather with what happened with the demonstrations in Leipzig over the weekend and other pandemic-related topics. How concerned are you when you see pictures from Leipzig and when you take into account that the people who take to the streets are inspired by conspiracy theories and are undermined and hollowed out by the right-wing extremist parties? I'm really concerned about that because our society is falling apart and is becoming ever more compartmentalized in filter bubbles and communication areas that are not really interconnected any longer. And especially these people are willing to deny any kind of fact-based information, and they don't read newspaper articles or publications from scholars that try to deny it, and they only believe whatever is happening in their bubble. This is rather a development that makes us be very concerned, and it also rocks the basic values of enlightenment and also the basic values of our society. Shoshana, in the interview that I just held with her, differentiated a little bit between platforms which react a bit more quickly and are based on the principle of dealing with highly sensitive political issues in a responsible manner. We've seen last week that almost every tweet by Twitter, on Twitter by Trump was blocked, but others are not really taking any action in this regard. The dissemination of fake news and erroneous information, especially during the election campaign, has had many tangible effects, as we've seen. Now, we've tried to see to it that the digital freedom of oppression is something that people learn to understand, that the full functioning of these platforms can be fully understood. But what's your take on this in these critical situations that we're currently in? How about the non-democratically run tools of communication that dominate our world? What's your take on that? I think they're very positive trends because the platforms are trying to take on responsibility as much as they can. This is a fact that we welcome. On the other hand, these platforms continue to refuse to give us an insight into filter options or sorting options or a flow so that every single user can decide how narrow the filters are going to be with regards to what interested me yesterday and the day before, or will that rather narrow my horizon and impede my decisions, or will I rather want to be bombarded with information from the outside world in order to keep this gate open? I think it's just the other side of the coin. Of course, these platforms are driven because they have to make money with advertisements. And this is where they want to be open and have a diverse debate. But this is not very much in line with that particular principle, because speed dating and the rapid reactions, many reactions that were triggered by these platforms, are in the economic interest of these platform operators. And this is where we have a conflict of interests, and they do not help us strengthen our democracy. These are basically public spaces, which are organized by private companies, and where people consider themselves to be users, although they are in the merchandise. And we have to think about ways and means of determining whether this is part of our common structure, common infrastructure in a socially democratic state. Is it important to keep these under private control where opinions are being made, yeah, or should we rather subject these platforms to some kind of democratic control? Well, two areas which are juxtaposed in the digital world and the network world, this alleged difference between freedom and liberty is supposed to be overcome. We've just seen that, especially in reaction to the terrible attacks that were committed in Vienna. The EU Council suggested to encrypt messenger services and chat services and to ban that. I think this is something that should be prevented from happening at any cost. But what is your take on that? What can we do during the pandemic? Because we really put our freedoms and rights into the spotlight. What can we do in order to prevent further surveillance? I think the police and the security services, with the surveillance possibilities that they should had so far, should do more in this regard. Now, last Saturday, demonstrations took place in Leipzig, and I commented that the organization of persons traveling to Leipzig, hooligans from Germany or even abroad, they made arrangements in the open network, maybe also in closed Telegram groups, I don't know. But they also made arrangements for meeting in the internet, but nobody reacted to that, although this was information that was publicly available. I think this has something to do with the fact that the security services are not really that familiar with the different ways and means of using the internet, and not really strongly represented, because otherwise encrypted communication could easily be come to terms with.
Right.
Let's move on to another topic. What is the current state of play in this digital world in Germany? I know we spoke about freedom and freedom rights. But let's briefly touch upon some different policy areas. What is the current state of play, and where do we have to take action as quickly as we can? I think in recent months we have all learned that there are some loopholes and gaps in Germany in the field of digitization. Of course, many of the topics that are related to that are topics where the federalist states, the federalist entities have to take action, but let us first of all talk about the availability of the infrastructure. It's beautiful there, and I would love to be there, but I would not love to live in a small village of Mecklenburg, West Pomerania, or Schleswig-Holstein without any good reception. I recently went to a workshop where we spoke about the mystery of the reasons that might be responsible for that. And here we said it's not a task of the state, but a task of the market. And if the market fails, does the state have to take any action? But, you know, during the pandemic, there will also still be places where you can't get a digital connection being established. Yes, that is the reason why we try to amend the Telecommunication Act, which is currently being debated in Parliament. Universal services of the internet, is that a common good that should be available to each and everyone, or should that be left to the forces of the market? For many years or decades have we tried to change that market-driven approach, and we try to make sure that digital services can be made available each and everywhere, but there's still some white and gray spots on the map, and they will continue to do so because these are regions which are not economically interested, and that is a big problem. A problem that we really have to deal with. We have come to the conclusion within my Social Democratic Party that the right to get access to a fast internet is a task of basic services to be provided to the general public. And that is why we want to change the acts and the regulations. Of course, we also need to do that at the European level. So Europe, too, needs to discuss these subject matters. But what's more, and I tried to explain that earlier on already, it's not about hardware and simple access with up and download rates, but it is also important to ensure that we offer platforms for communication and collaboration. We need platforms of which we know for sure that the communication will be kept confidential and will be safe, that data of the users will be used in the appropriate manner in line with our basic data protection regulation. And for that reason, I think that at the end of the day, it will be the task of the state or a state authority or a democratically controlled institution run by the public authorities to offer these services. This is what the previous panel also discussed. So these alternatives are feasible, they are possible, and people are thinking about them, have been thinking about them for quite some time. But I'm wondering, when will we finally get going? In Germany, we've been talking about the possibility to build platforms which are similar to our public TV stations. And maybe we can even make money with that, because the TV stations get a lot of fees, you know, in order to get things rolling, in order to get the ball rolling and to start off. Why not develop alternatives based on our values, social market democracy? When are we going to start?
I think it is important that now, when we have to prepare the next parliamentary elections and, of course, a government program for the election, that we ask this question: what does democratic digitalization mean for us? What has to be democratized in digitalization? We're in the middle of a process, and we ask exactly these questions you raise. What about access to the internet? That for most people is the first step, the search engine, when I look for information, requires a central access to the internet. But should that be in the hands of the private sector? And the company that operates the search engine also has their own interest in this platform. So this really confronts us with the question: can we do that with a private sector, or do we need a civil society or a government or a public alternative? And I believe we need that alternative.
I do too,
but I think we should do it relatively fast. There was a lot more plurality in the past regarding search engines and communication platforms. We often pretend to be helpless because the digital world is as it is, and we cannot do away with that. But it's not so long ago that we didn't have this monopoly of platforms. So shouldn't there be a new movement in France and in Germany demanding in a very targeted fashion that we build up alternatives and that we also have different types of regulation regarding the monopoly position of these platforms, for example, with respect to the fact that they're not paying any taxes? Well, these are debates that we're already in the middle of. We have initiatives that go in the direction of Gaia-X. This could be done in a more ambitious fashion, in a more focused fashion, and we should invest more commitment. But increasingly, people are convinced that this is the right approach. We heard from the Macron government that based on Signal, they are developing a messenger for their authorities and their offices. And we have similar considerations everywhere because people see the same problems everywhere. But on the other hand, as you said, as a reaction not only to the attacks in Vienna, but also to attacks in France, people want to break encryption rules, and the value of encryption and privacy are always mentioned, but then they want to have loopholes breaking these systems, and these loopholes are open to everyone. So we always have to find a balance, and this is a constant debate. I can imagine that a lot of people at first sight are against a government-provided infrastructure. So that's why this public entity idea is such a nice one. And you rightly say that with Corona, people open windows that we now should use. For example, in the business promotion package to deal with the political and economic consequences of Corona, under Section 42, we agreed that portals for marketing of restaurant offers and delivery offers of retailers are to be promoted, because we believe that all those winners of the crisis, basically Amazon and others, should be local entities. So this has a local economic effect, not only because of taxes,
absolut
but
notwendig. Das wurde auch im vorhergehenden Panel kurz angesprochen.
Well, the previous panel briefly covered
wenigen Plattformen, aber eben vielleicht sich auch diese regionalen Alternativen dazu denken
large
lassen,
wo eben there also easy alternatives on a local level, for example, with a network of bike messengers and local retailers, alternatives could be created. So it's good to hear from you that there are promotion and funding systems being developed. And what about bringing it to a higher level? I can imagine that there are lots of excellent regional individual ideas, but there could also be some value in interoperability of local solutions and joining forces on the next level. Well, this interoperability and this interconnection of standards should help us avoid an effect we had a lot in the past, and that is that developments that were made on grassroots level all of a sudden are called Lieferando and Foodora and take 15% of sales. And then you have this one provider who is the winner, and the winner takes it all. And exploits the small retailers. So what we want is that people can organize themselves. And if through interconnection and interface standards we promote cooperation, small players can also be successful. Well, I would like to come back to that in a minute. For example, data governance issues that you briefly touched upon. But before that, I have another question. You mentioned the example from France, where signal and administration chats were used. There are lots of great examples for things that are already happening. So can we develop some courage to use copy and paste in politics? Of course, people always want their own flagship projects and want to come up with something new that convinces the voters and that is good advertising for your party. But the open source examples we have, for example, the great DECOL project from Barcelona that Shona mentioned, or other initiatives. You mentioned Gaia-X. Maybe we should also look at IndiaStack and other experiences we can learn from. So how can we achieve more openness and more copying in politics, particularly at a time where we need quick solutions faster? Well, I think this is urgently necessary. I think networking and interconnection between players can be very important. We have a smart city movement all over Europe where the players in larger cities work together and exchange ideas. And I think it works quite well on this level. On the level of the national governments, it doesn't work so well yet, although in the European Council and in other groups, people get together. Maybe some additional structures would have to be created so the best practice examples of making progress could be used to learn from examples and to get ideas of what to imitate or copy. Well, smart city is also a buzzword in the business promotion package when it comes to digitalization and administration in connection with smart cities. I read the program, and I think it sounds all very nice, but don't we need new concepts for data management and data administration? Because this is still an area where there is a lot of lack of knowledge. I experience it every day in Berlin. There are still clichés. People don't know what to do regarding data protection in administration. Ideas like data stewardships or going beyond open source. This was discussed in a previous panel, where more common interest should be realized in data protection. Why don't you write that into the business promotion package? Well, a business promotion package is to make available funds for certain developments, because these funding programs would then have to be elaborated by the ministries in charge, and they have to develop concepts. I think the data strategy of the federal government that will be presented shortly, and that is partly already known, shows what concepts we already have in place. At the end of the last legislative period, we banked on open data and we passed an open data law. The federal agencies have to disclose their data. So the obligation and the willingness are there, but they might might not be able to do it. They don't have the capacity because the structures necessary are not in place. Competencies are lacking. The idea what data can be published and disclosed. How does that data have to be organized so they can be updated and others can use them? A lot of support is needed still in this area. So the open data law, and we wrote that into the coalition agreement, has to be developed further, also in direction of a transparency law. Now we have a lobby registry law project in our parliament that is being debated at the moment. All these questions are on the table, and they are also the responsibility of the federal chancellery, and I wish for a little bit more enthusiasm there, so we make progress regarding the open data law. So the regional administration and the federal administration has a treasure trove of data that has not been used, but companies also lack ideas what they and others could do with the data. So we have to have greater willingness of sharing data, a culture of sharing data. This doesn't affect personal data, of course. Personal data have to be separated, but other data without personal data or the depersonalized anonymous data can be used if they cannot be repersonalized. By the way, we are masters and experts of that in Germany, making this data available so new ideas can be developed. This is still an important project. The large monopoly-like companies that do not have their headquarters in Germany but in the United States, well, here we consider an obligation to share data, and the antitrust authorities also think that these companies, by abusing, illegally abusing data and keeping data in exclusive silos, are abusing their power and distort competition, which is detrimental for the market and for social development. Well, I wanted to mention the data sharing proposal. Does that only apply to large companies? During the previous panel, we also talked about mobility briefly. I think it's a good example. These e-scooters were authorized in a lot of cities, and some data are interesting, the non-personal data, for example, what are the main transport pathways, but this data has to be shared with the city administration so they can develop new mobility concepts. Some cities have already done it, others haven't. Should we have a more uniform approach that data sharing is a prerequisite for the large platforms in the interest of common benefits? So when should we do that, if not now? Well, now is always the right point in time. However, the question is what we can do with our coalition partner at the moment. We have good ideas, and so we try to also place them in the data strategy of the federal government, but they were not enthusiastic about all of our initiatives, so maybe we should include them in our election program. I want to be very clear that when it comes to mobility data in the city, another question is important, and that is who owns these data, because they are created or generated in the public sphere, and that companies can collect and keep the data also touches upon the question whether these are data that are generated only by using the e-scooters, because the user could be the owner of the data. And here the question is, whether we can solve the problem most easily by a data sharing obligation. But the question is also who owns the data. If I don't hire a car but rather buy it, and the automotive manufacturer still has a right to own the data for maintenance purposes or for learning from consumption data, etc., then my question is also who owns the data? It's my car. So why don't I also own the data? They are generated in the public sphere, the streets are a public good, but still the data generated there is not made available to the public. That is an important question we have to ask here. But altogether, we want to achieve a culture of data sharing, because companies, if they are obliged to share data, are not giving up anything, because they still have the data and they get access to data from others. They can also use that data for good technological development and innovative ideas. So we have to advertise this culture of data sharing. And we should make it clear that data should always be a common good, so not something new can be made from that. I always ask this question as a Berliner particularly. You're not responsible for policies in Berlin, but the party you represent has coalition partners in other federal states. And we have the problem we don't know what data we have or the data belong or are owned by a big company in the city and they don't like to share the data. So maybe this is one of my requests that you can take on board, and if that is your party line, you should also apply it in the federal capital. Well, I think we all have to convince the players and stakeholders. Sharing data is sharing knowledge, and that creates a certain transparency. And also, players in the public administration are not always thrilled about it, because they always have concerns that people want to control them so they can no longer act the way they acted, not to mention the big company, because that also involves market power. But I do not want to limit our focus to the large tech companies abroad who are monopolists. We also want to look at other players who exclusively own data. So the data sharing obligation should also apply to them. Well, I completely agree with you. I would like to come to another topic. I mentioned that a lot of the digital issues that are important at the moment are the responsibility of the federal states and are part of the federal system here in Germany. We talked about infrastructure, but I would also like to talk about digital education, because I also fear in this context that particularly here in Berlin, I don't know what the situation is in other federal states, but friends from other federal states say the same. Here we are actually in a blocked situation. I heard a person on public radio who refused to introduce any digital concepts into the Corona Corona education concept for primary schools and secondary lower level schools, but I also hear it from people who are working in adult education and in vocational schools who say that e-learning and digital learning concepts are very difficult to realize. You, as a digital politician, will be just as astonished. But what are the reasons why we are in this lockdown? Well, I've been dealing with this problem for a long time, for 7 years actually, ever since I joined the federal parliament. There are individual schools and teachers who are very committed, who are very advanced, who practice a lot of digital education or education in the digital world, modern education in the digital world, and others are lagging behind. I think Corona made us see what we need and what we're lacking. And that is why, in connection with the business promotion package and in connection with the school summit, we opened up the coffers of the federal government and dedicated €500 million for terminals for students in digital learning, students whose parents cannot afford buying computers and terminals. And another €500 million was invested in buying computers for teachers, because the devil's in the detail. The teachers work at home, basically on their computers, they prepare their classes digitally, but then they print it and work in an analog fashion in school. So students do their homework on their computers at home in the afternoon, but then they work with printouts in schools. So we don't have enough digital devices in schools, so we needed them for teachers. Schools are not so well connected yet. They have a computer room with 5 computers, with their limited up and download rates, but they cannot make it available to 50 or 500 users. So the local authorities rather provide new housing areas with digital access, but not the existing neighborhoods. So Corona already brought about some change, but this is not only the case in Berlin, but everywhere. In connection with the school summit, we arrived at the conclusion that we need a better connection of existing platforms. We have to network competencies. We have to network teachers and offer teacher education digitally so people can learn more. But the willingness under Corona conditions to try new things, to have hybrid classes, to have also divided hybrid classes, that willingness is not very widespread yet. So with these methods, we could protect people against infections, because we have increasing infection numbers in schools. That is concerning. And willingness in schools is not so great yet. But of course, that doesn't apply to all schools. We heard about the school in Solingen that wanted to have a digital concept because their infection numbers were so problematic, but the Ministry of Culture prohibited it. So that is, of course, very problematic. If individual schools take the initiative and want to be pioneers, are forbidden to do so, and if the ministries don't even discuss it or don't even want to try it in vocational schools, at least in order to make some experiences and to take some additional steps.
This is not at all understandable. I know of students who have already organized petitions which are sent to the educational authorities because they are very much aware of the fact that these connections are missing. But it's not up to the schools or the individual teachers, as you said, because they develop a lot of creativity, as we've already seen during the first wave of this pandemic. And they're really, really committed. But this is not enough. And therefore, it's not understandable. And if some people refuse to join in, what can be done? Do we really have to stick to all the federal structures that do exist, although we've really realized that some of them have turned out to be rather difficult? And different federal states move into different directions. What do you make of that? The federal structure has its pros, most definitely so, because they can always take account of differences at the federal state levels or different regions even. But still, it is necessary that we try to join forces and take action jointly when we develop standards. The Conference of Ministers of Cultures was established decades ago for particularly that purpose. There were times, and I remember the year 2015-16, I think it was in 16, when the Conference of Ministers of Cultures adopted resolutions for digital education and made major headway within a short space of time. But, of course, it's difficult to enforce these regulations at the federal state level. But I think the investments of the federation really were a help. So I think we are on the right track. It just takes time. But in the current situation during the pandemic, saying that this is the right moment in time, now we really want to change our structures fundamentally so, and now we want to offer new concepts, requires more willingness than is currently available at the different schools. Thank you very much. This is probably one of the things where action needs to be taken, because we've talked about this topic for quite some time and we are full of despair. I think that we will hopefully soon reach a breakthrough. Before we ask the questions from our virtual audience, during the last panel we spoke about public goods and we also spoke about the common good. We spoke a little bit about health as well. But let me ask you a very general question. Apart from the field of digital education, where do you think do most important changes have to take place as soon as possible? What should we really focus on during the pandemic? And what should be declared to be our public goods in order not to go back to business as usual, but for us to be able to embark on new paths and end up with a completely new set of values? I think it is very important that we use the capability of civil society to get organized and collaborate and develop new ideas. We should also do that on digital platforms and tap that potential. This should not be done by privately organized companies which only and exclusively pursue their own interests. This is what I tried to explain already earlier on when I spoke about the search engines and platforms for communication and collaboration and exchange. They need to be controlled by public entities. This is why it is one of our agreements of the summit meeting that was reached for schools that textbooks and teaching material and platforms for cooperation, school clouds, need to be promoted as much as possible. And at the national level, we want to open these platforms up even for those who are not working at schools or educational institutions in order to provide them with access. I think education needs to be publicly run and open. And this is why this is one of my utmost priorities. And the same holds true for the organization of civil society organizations. The public infrastructure, the digital infrastructure, should also be controlled by the public, but it should predominantly be subjected to democratic control. In recent months, we've had a lot of discussions about the question of digital sovereignty in connection with the backbone of our society, the internet. In our core net and in the general internet, can we let components to be manufactured of which we don't know which backdoors they contain and which risks that they might impose on our societies, on our public life, on all our citizens' lives? So therefore, I'm deeply convinced of the fact that this is where action needs to be taken. This is where strong control needs to be exerted, democratic control. And last but not least, you briefly touched upon this already, we talk about data. Data already managed by the public, but not publicly available, because this data cannot be published. What is generated with public funds should also be available to the general public. Public money, public good is the slogan, in order to create additional value for our society. That is our task, and that is where progress needs to be made. Public money, public good, great buzzword. Maybe we'll come back to that in a minute. But now let me pass the floor to Tobias Müller, who collect the questions from our virtual spectators. What's happening at Twitter, Tobias? Twitter's there. And some tweeters ask very important questions. Saskia, we're happy to have you here. Now, let us give our spectators the floor. One important question relates to the future that you discussed several times this afternoon. A digital ministry run by the Social Democratic Party, what would be its first priority after the election in 2021? Well, the first question is, do we need a ministry for digital affairs? This is a very heated debate with controversial discussions. Digitization and its democratic control, of course, needs to be one of the main priorities during the next election campaign at the national level. A minister, male or female, with its own resources and its own power, should take action in this particular regard. This is what we've discussed several times, but it is also ministry important is that all the ministries, institutions and agencies involved in the national policy realm do their job, do their homework, because we want to establish much better connection than is currently existing at the federal level. And a lot is going on. That is our most important task.